G'day, Charger here, and I'm going to do a little quick review for a very cool little game, Atlantis by Leo Colvinini. I don't know how to pronounce his name, but that's that guy. This is like a very, very simple game, but it's great for playing with non-gamers, and it's great for playing with, like after the day's over kind of thing. It's only got one little sheet of instructions. And it's very, 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 very simple. It's got a beautiful box too. Well, Atlantis, what to say about this little gem? Well, I love it. I really think this is a great game. And there's a few reasons for this. One of the things is that I find the design of this game to be rock solid. There's what I term, I don't really know what it's called, but I see it in games. People confuse complexity with a good game design. And I actually believe it's the opposite. The less complex the game, like the mechanics of the game, the better the game design. Now, that doesn't mean I don't like complex games. I do. I really like complex games. But I like the complexity to be in the decision making inside me, inside the human player, not inside the game components, you know what I mean? You don't want to, like games that have, oh, this is happening, so this is happening, now this has to happen, and you know, make sure when you do this, you got to do that and that and that. That's not complexity. That's sort of like minutiae that you have to remember to do. The less of that there is, the less complexity in the actual game mechanics, the deeper the play experience is, because you just play the game. It becomes very natural. You just do it rather than having to think about all these convoluted rules. Now, while this game obviously isn't like that, it's just a simple game. But it has that same kind of beauty to the design that I just find very impressive. And, I mean, this is a game you can literally, I mean, this is going to have a rules primer at the end, which is going to cover the whole rule book. So it's going to go for a little longer, but you can literally teach this game with like a few sentences and get people playing. Play a card, move your pawn to the same color treasure. And that's literally all you need to do to start playing, pretty much. Well, obviously there's a few more things, but my point is it's very simple. So where does the fun come from this game? How does this game become fun with such a simple premise? Well, for starters, it's a race game, so it's non-combative. I mean, you sort of interfere with each other with the way the water breaks work, but it's more about the experience around the table. I'm playing, I'm doing something, there's actually an activity that's linking us all together, but the game itself is not trying to be the major focus here. It's a fun little game, but the goal of the game is to have us all sit around the table. I think that's very interesting and very, very key to a whole style of games. Now, because of that, this game works fantastic with families. It's great to play with children, and it's really good for those long, long sessions. You know, like you've just played Seven Ages and you're coming off, you know, like a 26-hour gaming session that's split over 2 days, and you're like, oh, wow, I just need a break. But, you know, the game's not over, you know, the day's not over, you're still hanging out with your friends, so you put something very light on the table. And this is a great one. People call them filler games. And this is a great example of a filler game. Good for non-gamers, really good for gamers, and just has a beauty in the design that I find, I just think it's a great little game. And I strongly recommend people play it. So check it out. It's called Atlantis. It's very, very similar to another game that he made called Cartagena, which is kind of like a piratey sort of game. It's almost identical kind of idea, except there's no point collection, there's no interference, it's really just a pure racing game. And that's where Atlantis stands out, because not only is it a racing game, there's actually goals that the player has to achieve. You've got to collect points, you've got to cross the rivers, you've got to figure out where the, you know, do I want to get a point or do I want to take a tile that makes my enemies take points? When do I put my bridge down? You know, there's actually decision points in this that make it quite a rich game, even considering its rather simple premise. But so yeah, if you're looking for a pretty cool game, check this one out. It's a nice little filler, it's cheap, you can usually find it in secondhand stores because it's criminally underlight. And yeah, so stay tuned for the rule primer. So this is what the board's going to look like once you finish setting up. Now remember, the shape of the path is completely irrelevant. You just have to draw a line between Atlantis and the mainland. And it goes, see these tiles here, there's two tiles on top of each other. And you'll note they've also got the little letter A. While these tiles over here, after the water break, are labeled letter B. And it's very, very simple to remember. You just go stacks of two, you go 10, then a stack of one. So these have only got one tile. 10, and then stack of two, 10. Stack of two, 10. Stack of one, 10. Stack of two, 10. And that's how you build the map. And we're ready to start playing now. All we need to do is give a bridge token to each individual player. That's kind of free action, we'll get to a sec. And then deal out these cards. And these are the crux of the cards, these are the movement cards. And they're just colored cards. So what happens is, going in order of youngest to oldest, that's the youngest player is the first player in this game. We find that extremely unfair, because there's actually a bit of a advantage to going last, in my opinion. So we randomly choose who's going first. First player gets 4 cards, next player 5 cards, next player 6 cards, next player 7 cards. Now, the goal of this game is not only to flee Atlantis, but to take as much treasure as possible out of the city. We're trying to save all the treasures of Atlantis. And that's what all these things are on the path. You'll note that if we look at them a little more closely, each tile has a numeric value. These are victory points. Now the way you pick up tiles is, if I move here to the 6, right, you pick up the tile directly behind you. In this case, a nice juicy 6-point crown. Ooh, nice. Now this is free information and is placed inside your victory pile, you know, just your play area, and other players can see this, it's not hidden. Now you'll note, in this case, because this was a single tile, it left a big gap. So this gap is filled with a water. And that is one of the crux design elements of this game. As you play and you remove tiles, it'll slowly create more and more and more gaps that you have to get across. Now each player only has a single bridge that they can deploy. But one of the interesting things is, like say these two tiles were taken, a new water tile would be placed, but that would still count as one gap. There's actually no, like, it doesn't matter how many pieces of water there are, once they're connected, it becomes a single crossing, okay? So this, while this only looks like it only covers one thing, if I had a bridge here, it would cover as many waters as are connected. Now the way you play the game is that you have your sequence of cards and you simply play them from your hand. So you look at these colors, and you simply move your pawn, I'll be blue, to the matching color. So if I played a black, which is quite a good one to play, we look along here, and we see that there is the first black tile is all the way up there. So we place it on the first tile that matches the color and take the tile behind it. We just scored 1 point, which isn't worth a lot. And we put down a new order. Now that I've finished my go, this card gets discarded. Just leave it there, and then I draw a new card to replenish the one I spent. Now, no matter how many cards I spend, I only ever draw one at the beginning of the game. So the next player, white, might play a pink, and that will move his piece all the way to the pink tile. Bang, and then he takes this tile behind him, which is worth 2 points, but look, there's a tile underneath it, so no water's formed. Then of course he draws, yonk. Now, it is possible to play more than one card at a time. And the way you do that is this. If red plays a pink tile, that moves him all the way to the pink tile here, because it's the first pink tile in the list. Now, he can play another card. And it doesn't have to follow suit. He can play any of the cards in his hand. So, he has a blue. So, he's going to play a blue and go here. Bam! And take a really juicy 7. 7 is the highest point you can get in the game for any individual tile. And that is basically the way you play. You just keep playing your colors and moving your pawns to the first available color. If you land upon someone else's pawn, you then get another turn. But once you land, you draw the tile directly behind. So, for example, if blue had landed here on this two, so blue landed on this two, he can't take this tile because there's someone there, there's a water here, so he actually takes the four. Yonk. And it always ricochets back in that order. So if there's a line of people, like say this, and I move to the five, bang, because there's a line here, I'd skip, 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 and I'd take my piece from here. Now, how do we cross the water? Now, there is obviously a penalty for water. Basically, whenever you try and cross a water, you have to pay the lowest of the two costs that surround it. So, example, if I wanted to move past this water, no matter where I went, I would have to pay, there's a three here and a two here, so the cost is two. And I can pay that various ways. I can either pay using coin, like victory points that I actually acquire. Now see how this is a three, you never get change. So if I pay with a three, even though I only need to pay two, because that's the lower that surrounds it, I still lose the three. And that goes into a discard pile, never to be seen again. I can also pay by discarding cards. Now cards are quite valuable, they're all worth one victory point at the end of the game, but I could pay that two cost by spending 1 point in victory piles and then discarding one card, because the cards all equal one. So that adds 2 points, and that gets me across here. If I move this white pawn, which is all the way down here, all the way over to here, which is possible because of the leapfrogging mechanics, because like I said, if I land on any other character, I can then cast another card. And you can do that as many times as you want, but cards are really important, keep them in your hand. But say I moved from down here all the way up to here, I've crossed one, two, three different areas of water. So I would have to look, this one would cost two because there's a three and a two surrounding it, you take the lowest, that's two. This one's a terrible one, it's a one and a one, so who cares, we just pay one, so we now have a total of three. And this one here is a five and a two, so we have to pay two. So that's two, three, four, five. So I would need to pay 5 points to do this move. Otherwise the move is illegal and it can't be done. And I could pay that with a six token if I had it. Each player also has a bridge and they can use this bridge once. And you can place this bridge as a sort of like a free action during your payment phase. Basically the same time you're paying for your crossings. And you can just place a bridge anywhere you want. So bam, I put a bridge there. And that now is free to cross. That area is now completely free. But it's free for every single character. So if the white put the bridge here, he's basically paved the way for all these guys to cross that without paying any costs. Now each person has a bridge, and the bridges aren't worth anything at the end of the game, but you can use them quite effectively. Let's have a look at this situation here.
Just imagine though that the bridge isn't actually there, because while there is a bridge here, there are no costs of any sort.
We have a five here and a five here. So if these two ever got taken away and a new water was placed, remember this is all a single mark, it doesn't matter how many waters there. Now, we have a five here and a five here, which means it's five to cross that water. That's really, really expensive. That's a great way to hinder other players, is thinking about the tile, not only the points you're taking, but how many points you're forcing them to take.
But as you can see, this particular gap has a bridge, so that cost is completely nullified. So that's what you can do. You've all got a bridge each, and you can place the bridge anywhere you want and nullify the cost of crossing. But the interesting thing is that all players can use the bridge. It's not just for your use. Anyone can use it. So you've got to think carefully about the positioning when you put down a bridge.
Now there is an abstract element. If any tile is removed from the base like that, like if these tiles are removed, instead of that becoming a water, the island just sort of moves up, okay? So there's never a water space between the island and Atlantis and the first bridge, okay? Even if the tiles are removed and the water is revealed, it just fills up. The way I like to do it is I just put a water tile down upside down like this to simulate that that's still a land. If at any time you have no moves, like for example, say blue here, he's got no moves because he has to pay 5 to get across this, well, say that bridge is there. He's got to pay 5 to get across this gap, but he hasn't got 5 points and none of his colors match any of the colors here. And what you have to do, you have to reveal your hand completely to the other players. Obviously this hand doesn't count because there's a green, but you'd reveal your hand completely to the other players to ensure that there's no cheating. And then once they've assumed that you've got no cheating, you can then draw 2 cards and end your turn without moving any of your figures. This is really rare. I've never seen it actually happen. Far more common than that, like a very common thing is that you can actually, as your turn begins, you can sell your victory points for cards. And what you do, you halve it and round it down. So this is worth 3 cards. So I can trade this in, chuck it into the discard pile, and draw 3 cards before my turn begins. Now, you want to be very careful with this. Having cards give you flexibility, and remember they're all worth a point, but the goal of the game is to get these victory points. So you don't want to be spending too much money traveling. You want to have as much as when to get home, you know what I mean? So it's a bit of a balance thing going on here. Once a player gets to Atlantis, you now draw a second card. For each character you get home, you draw a second card. So in this case, red has 2, so at the end of his turn, he draws the first card as normal, and then he draws the next 2 cards for 1 for each man. That gives him 3. White, on the other hand, will get the normal card, and then he'd get a second card because he has a guy on Atlantis. So what this basically means is that it's a race game at heart. It's cards are obviously the currency of the game. You need your cards, and you want to get your at least 1 guy to Atlantis as fast as possible. It's actually a pretty valid tactic to race one way ahead. But at the same time, if you leave too many people up the back here, there's going to be all these gaps that you have to pay to get through, and you're going to be spending all your hard-earned treasures to get across the water, which is, you know, basically loses you the game. Because remember, the end of the game, whoever has the most cards, the most points wins. Each tile's worth a point, each card's worth a point. So red's got 2 there already. So if he gets a 3rd character to Atlantis, the game end sequence is now triggered. His turn, he still gets to draw again. So he'll draw a whopping 4 cards. 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's worth 4 points, basically, to get to Atlantis first, all your people. Now, the normal turn sequence is interrupted. What happens now is everyone else who is still out on the board has to travel home. They've got to move all the way home and pay all costs. So this guy, the black here, he would just go straight home. Boom, there's no cost, there's no breaks in the thing. His other pawn would have to pay 5 for this water, 5 for this water, and then get home. Blue would also have to pay 5, 5, and home. And these 3 here, which are all the way up on Atlantis still, would have to pay 1, 2, 3, 5, 5, so I'd play 13 to get home. And once all the points are calculated, you then count up and to get them home. If no one can pay the bills to get home, they drown and they're out of the running, basically. That means you can't win if you don't get all your people home. So once you have everyone home, you just count up the points. And that's game. And just remember that when you're counting your victory points, not only are you counting all your tiles, you're also counting how many cards you have in your hand, because every card is also worth a point. That's why the first person to get to Atlantis, because they get to draw 4 cards, is basically getting a 4-point buffer. Like I said, this is a very simple game, very fun to play, and it's nice and light, but has enough stuff going on in it that you feel there is an actual game here. It's not what I'd call a party game, but it's great for playing with non-gamers. It's great for playing after a long session of something heavy, you know. Oh, we'll have a coffee or a beer and wind down and play this game. It's nice and fun and simple. I really enjoy this game. Now, I usually play it with 3. I haven't played it too many times with four. I do play it with four, but I find that with four people, there are so many bridges that the costs of getting home are so reduced that it's almost inconsequential. And when I play with four, we often play with no bridges. We've also tried a variant where we play with two bridges and anyone can activate them, but it costs them 2 points to place. That's quite, because it benefits everyone, and that worked out really well for four players. But three players, the game is really, really sweet. It's definitely my favorite number for playing this game, which is good again because there aren't that many three-player games. So yeah, this is Atlantis, and it's a pretty awesome game. And I'm pretty sure that's everything. Now, I've obviously gone through the rules in quite a lot of detail, but it's actually extremely simple. You set up the board, you play a card, you get your color, you move to that color, you pick up the tile behind you. That's pretty much it. For water, you pay the cost of the cheaper of the surrounding tiles. So 3 and 2, you pay 2. And that's almost the entire rules of the game. The only other thing is, if you land on a tile where there's another player, you have to play another card. I don't know if I stressed that before, but you have to play another card. And that's pretty much it. Atlantis, quite a cool little game. One I would recommend to anybody. I'll see you next time.